Today we will be discussing about history taking in nose, paranasal sinus and nasopharynx. The next symptom the patient might present to you is postnasal discharge or postnasal drip. So postnasal drip is a sensation of discharge streaking to the back of the throat. This is a feature seen in patients with chronic nose condition like chronic rhinitis or sinusitis. Patient would complain of mucus discharge trickling down the back of throat, which would lead to hawking or constant throat clearing. So these are the symptoms that the patient might present to you with. Next, we will ask about history of headache or facial pain. So if a patient presents to you with headache or facial pain, ask when he noticed it and how it started. Is it constant or intermittent? What is the exact site? How severe is it? Does he have fever? What is the character of pain, whether it is sharp shooting, cutting or dull aching type? How is it aggravated and relieved? Is there any diurnal variation? Are there any associated nasal symptoms of nausea, vomiting or giddiness? Are there any color halos in front of eyes? Does the patient have a normal vision or use glasses? Is there restricted painful neck movements? So all these conditions should be asked if a patient has headache or facial pain. This would help you to rule out the differential diagnosis of headache. So if the headache or facial pain is due to nose and paranasal sinuses, then you have to ask about onset, duration, laterality, character, severity, aggravating and relieving factors, associated URTI and past history. Talking about character of headache or facial pain, headache may be sharp shooting during acute sinusitis and dull aching during chronic sinusitis. Headache due to particular sinus may have typical features which help us to recognize the sinus involved in the patient. When all the sinuses are involved, the condition is called pansinusitis. So, in cases of frontal sinusitis, the peculiar features are frontal headache, which is usually severe and localized over the affected sinus. It shows characteristic periodicity, that is, comes up on waking, gradually increases and reaches its peak by about midday and then starts subsiding. This is also called office headache because of presence only during the office hours. The characteristic headache or facial pain in case of maxillary sinusitis are: it is usually confined to the cheek of involved side, facial pain typically situated over the upper jaw but may be referred to the gums or teeth. Pain is aggravated by stooping, coughing or chewing. Occasionally, pain is referred to the ipsilateral supraorbital region and thus may simulate frontal sinus infection. The characteristic of headache in ethmoid sinusitis are: pain is localized over the bridge of the nose, medial and deep to the eye. It is aggravated by movements of the eyeball. Lids become puffy and swollen. There is increased lacrimation. Orbital cellulitis is an early complication in such cases. In sphenoid sinusitis, the patient has headache which is usually localized over the occiput or vertex. Pain may also be referred to the mastoid region in such cases. So this is about headache in nose and paranasal sinuses. The other symptom that the patient may present to you is nasal mass. So if the patient comes to you with complaint of nasal mass, then ask about onset, duration, laterality, latency, character, smell, aggravating and relieving factors, and past history. So let's deal with all these conditions. Onset and duration of nasal mass. Ask the patient how was it noticed, whether the patient himself or herself noticed it or someone else did. So acute causes of nasal mass are because of septal hematoma or foreign body. In chronic, nasal polyps, nasal or paranasal sinus malignancy may be the causes. Ask about the laterality of nasal mass, which side is involved, whether it is unilateral or bilateral. Unilateral nasal mass may be because of deviated nasal septum, foreign body, entroconal polyp, inferior turbinate hypertrophy, concha bullosa, paranasal tumor or malignancy, whereas bilateral nasal mass may be because of septal hematoma or abscess, bilateral inferior turbinate hypertrophy, ethmoidal polyp, nasopharyngeal tumor. The other condition that the patient may present to you with is swelling or deformity of the nose. Ask the patient when he noticed swelling over nose or face for first time. Ask about history of trauma. Is the swelling static, progressive or regressive? Associated nasal symptoms like nasal obstruction, rhinorrhea, anosmia, epistaxis should be inquired. Swellings following trauma may be because of soft tissue injury of nasal bone or facial bones. Swellings since birth may be dermoid or meningocele. Inflammatory and neoplastic conditions can also give rise to swelling in this area. So let's continue with other symptomatology. Disturbance of smell. If a patient complains of disturbance of smell, you have to ask about the onset, duration, character or type, and aggravating and relieving factors. Onset and duration of disturbance of smell may be acute or chronic. Acute condition of disturbance of smell may be because of common cold, allergic rhinitis, trauma, because of head injury or nose trauma. In chronic, it may be because of nasal mass or polyp, chronic sinusitis or atrophic rhinitis. Character or type of disturbance may be anosmia, which is total loss of sense of smell, example in cases of head injury, or functional hyposmia, there is reduced sense of smell, example in cases of rhinitis, nasal polyps or nasal allergy. Parosmia, where there is altered sense of smell, in cases of allergic rhinitis. Cacosmia, any smell is experienced as foul, in cases of chronic sinusitis. The other symptom that the patient may present to you is change in voice, which may be hyper or hyponasality. The conditions of hyponasality or rhinolalia clausa, it is a lack of nasal resonance of words which are resonated in the nasal cavity, example mo, no, and mo. It may be present in cases of common cold, nasal allergy, nasal polyp, nasal growth, adenoids, nasopharyngeal mass, familial speech pattern, or may be habitual. The causes for hypernasality or rhinolalia operata. It is seen when certain words which have little nasal resonance are resonated through nose. This may be seen in cases of velopharyngeal insufficiency, congenital short soft palate, submucous cleft palate, large nasopharynx, cleft of soft palate, paralysis of soft palate, post-adenoidectomy status, oronasal fistula, familial speech pattern, or habitual. The other symptom patient may be presenting with is snoring. Snoring is a partial obstruction to nasal or oropharyngeal air passage during sleep, resulting into a peculiar noise called snoring. In children, it may be because of adenotonsillar hypertrophy. In adults, it may be because of certain conditions of nose or nasopharynx like septal deviation, turbinate hypertrophy, nasal valve collapse, nasal polyp or tumors, conditions of oral cavity and oropharynx like elongated soft palate and uvula, tonsillar enlargement, microglossia, retrognathia, large base of tongue or its tumor, conditions of larynx and laryngopharynx like laryngeal stenosis or omega sept epiglottis, other conditions like obesity and thick neck with collar size exceeding 42 cm. Use of alcohol, sedatives and hypnotics aggravates snoring due to muscle relaxation. The symptoms that a patient of snoring may present are: a snorer with obstructive sleep apnea may manifest with excessive daytime sleepiness, general fatigue, irritability and depression, increased risk of road accidents, morning headache, memory loss, decreased libido. So these are the common symptoms a patient with nose or paranasal sinus condition present to you with. Thank you for listening.